How do we do the most sustainable development possible? How do we pick the right material choices to show that we are reducing the embodied carbon, but also providing maximum fire safety? How do we make sure that the development fits into its surrounding, even though it's so innovative and so different to what is around traditionally? How do we show that we can make this viable on a social rental level, but hopefully we bring the standard up of the general construction industries and really make a dent in the climate emergency targets? The key questions is, how do we provide net zero carbon and low carbon housing for those in housing need within the social housing sector, on time, on budget, to a high level, while still including all those criteria within our design ethos? I was working with a construction supply company, and I'm very into my diving. So I did a trip and looked at coral bleaching and could really see the effects of climate change that were starting to happen, and thought, you know, I've got to be part of a solution here. So I actually then went back to university and I did a master's in environmental strategy and science. I then looked at doing an engineering doctorate in sustainable energy systems and design. So I have a very strong environmental background. That led me down to the route of really it was working more on along the lines of these sort of self-built individual dwellings, and thought, you know, if we keep doing that, the pace of change is far too slow and we're not going to meet those climate change abatement targets. So it's then looking at how we then move that quicker through the market. Bristol is one of the first councils in the UK to declare the climate emergency. They were such a good match to our sustainable ethos and what they wanted to achieve. When you look at what land a lot of the local councils still own, they're either garage sites, car park sites, hard standing sites, or brownfield sites. And a lot of the city centre sites that we're looking at are existing car park sites. By working closely with Bristol Council, we managed to put this really, really great location here in Chalks Road, because you've got the park next to it, you've got a lot of local businesses, you've got two supermarkets, you've got a train station within walking distance, so you've got everything you need to be here so that we can encourage a car-free development. What's quite unique about this is we've raised the whole building above the parking level. We've actually maintained the same amount of parking bays. The council hasn't had to sell this land, they can maintain the land. So therefore, that they're not having to incur that land cost. We're not competing with the existing land use, and we're providing those windfall sites for housing, which is really a unique thing. It brings back to the benefits of people being able to live where they need to live, to reduce their transport time, to reduce their transport costs. The housing that we're developing and the sites that we're using are right where they need to be. Because you're raised at one story above car parking level, you're almost in the trees. It creates a really sort of nice living condition. Then you can look out on your balcony and you can see the park. It's a lovely setting. These are one bed, one person accommodation that we're in at the moment. You have a quite high quality, nice fitted kitchen. You've got that open space living downstairs, which is quite akin to most of the modern designs. What we've done different is split the apartment so that you go upstairs to bed. So you've got a nice full-size tiled bathroom. And then you've got the upstairs living space, but also with the nice mezzanine level, the skylight, which provides additional lighting in here as well. This is essentially your desk working space with an outlook and a window like that. So we're looking at accommodating home working, providing a really beautiful space to be able to work from home if you need to. If you're building something that's very, very high tech and high quality, you do it in the most controlled environment that you can do. You wouldn't build a high-tech car in the middle of a field, so why build a high-tech home in the middle of a field? You want to build it in a factory. So we have a factory in Peterborough where this is being built and brought to site completed in two sections effectively. And then they're buttoned up and put round together. Things where you want the extra attention to detail are done in a closed environment, in a nice warm environment, that are not subject to the external elements, that are done at low level in a safer environment, which gives you the longevity in the build and which gives you the attention to detail so that the as designed energy loads and the actual energy loads marry together. Modular building should be seen as an evolution of traditional building, not as a separate market, not as something that has a niche, not that something that is just to do for a certain amount of time or a certain percentage of the population or a certain percentage of the housing need. We could do wide buildings, we can do standard apartments, we can do split level apartments, we can do maisonettes, we can do 1, 2, 3 bed flats, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bed homes. We can work off the grid-based modular system that we use to have real flexibility in how we do it. I'm really passionate about showing what we can do and showing that schemes like this are viable commercially, technically, economically, and that we can deliver them in such a quick timescale that it really questions why you would go down the traditional building route. We have a very high quality control process for waste. So it's precision cuts. All the insulation we use is natural material. So it's either a stone wall or a glass mineral wall. And we've designed it so that the buildings use the standard roll thicknesses, which means there's minimum amounts of offcuts. The wood pellets that are then used to provide a combined heat and power to the factory as well to help reduce the energy requirement. We only have one skip, which is much, much less than you'd find on any traditional building site. We minimise the amount of concrete that we use. So we use a screw pile foundation system on the scheme that we've got, or we use a CFA pile foundation, which means it's minimum ground excavation and again reduces that construction waste. These are permanent homes that are designed to live in and compete with the traditionally built homes. They're not a separate market like containerised solutions maybe. You'll see that these are very light buildings. These are wider, we have natural building materials, which means the buildings are breathable. It doesn't trap vapor or moisture in there. You get much better acoustics inside of it. They're going to appreciate in value, and they're going to last for a significant amount of people to go through a number of generations to live in. What the developers do and what the large builders do is what is the choices in the market. If we can sort of start bringing that little bit of disruption into the market that says, this is the alternative. And once people start seeing that this is in the social housing sector, then the public starts to demand in more of the private housing sector, this is the sort of quality we want. This is the types of building we want to do. What's the sustainability credentials of a building? What's the energy rating of the building I'm moving into? I think the difficulties that we face now are very different to what we faced 5 years ago or 10 years ago or even 15 years ago. The technical barriers I don't think are there anymore. I think we've addressed them. We know what we know what works, we know what lasts, and we know what's easy to use and easy to live in. The costs and the simplification of the technologies means that these are fit and forget. Very, very simple to use, very, very simple to live in. We use a solar-assisted heat pump, which enables us to produce low carbon heating and hot water because it's super insulated, airtight dwelling with triple glazing and natural building materials. The heat that we generate as people, the heat that you generate from cooking, from turning on your toaster in the morning, from making a cup of tea, that is enough to generally provide enough heat into the building so that the heating system is just topping it up to maintain it at that initial comfort level. The majority of the energy is to provide hot water for shower and bathing. We can then offset that energy through the solar PV. It's A-rated appliances, it's low energy lighting throughout, so that we can just use standard solar panels, grid connected, that offset the residual energy demand that a building like this has. Over the course of the year, we're generating more energy than what the building consumes, and therefore it could be net zero carbon. We're trying to switch from that capital build model to that life cycle cost building model that brings into account the cost of living, the cost of energy production, the cost of carbon, to show that actually over the course of building, this might be at the same price as building a traditional building, but when you look at the life cycle cost, the building's far, far cheaper. If you look at a lot of zero carbon homes in the UK, there are just sort of grand design type schemes where you're doing one great unit, but you're not really attacking the vast majority of the market. We've got schemes that are going through planning at the moment that are private developer led. Again, it's just going back to where we come from as a company, that we really thought the social housing sector was where we should be targeting, because we think we can make the greatest amount of good in delivering high quality new homes in there. It's a very strange time at the moment in terms of what we do in a city and how a city changes. We're embodying as much of that flexibility as we possibly can do, bringing more homes into that city centre, into that area that can support local businesses and the local businesses that are really, really suffering at the moment, I think is a way forwards as well, and something that's quite necessary. We're trying to show that people can, one, live a car-free lifestyle. If you reduce car usage, then also you're having a massive impact on the climate change abatement targets, as well as doing the energy that's in use within the building. But it's more for a case of people that are living close to where they need to be working, and that reduces commuting time, which gives you more personal time, which, you know, again, helps with health and well-being. You're reducing your transport costs and can help with your disposable income. And it really shows that you can have a high standard of living within a city centre, even if you're doing for social rental. We're not reducing car parking spaces at the moment, but we're increasing things like the amounts of electric car charging bays. Yes, we could essentially go down and create more dwellings on the car level if you find that we get to a point where we don't need to use the car parks anymore. But I think we're a long way away from that. Being the first to do things, you always come up with different questions, with different technologies, with different things that you and hurdles you have to overcome. The fact that we're showing that we can do it in the social housing sector really should open the markets up. And there's a lot of great people in Bristol City that really helped push the scheme forward and really bought into what we were trying to do. And we believe this is one of the highest quality, low carbon schemes, not just in social housing, in general. You've got a lot of natural daylight, a lot of really good features that it's going to really, really bring up the standard of living in social housing. We can be seen as that small tugboat dragging that big oil tanker, if you like, of the existing building industry. And if we can do that in our small way here, if we can start seeing that going out further into the market and start seeing that change, then we're all going to benefit, not just as Zpods, but as a country, and hopefully, you know, globally, by seeing what can be achieved to abate climate change in a short period of time. This is such a keynote scheme, especially to do it for a social housing perspective. We're combining the economic benefits, the environmental benefits, and the social benefits in the scheme that really develops such a high quality build. It's for a lifestyle change, for a cost of living change, and to avoid those difficult decisions for people that are in social housing about whether they can heat their home or whether they can feed their family. We want to get rid of all of that.